Oh, look at me, I'm standing again! What to do, what to do, what to do, what to do? Docked! Howdy, hey there, and hello. I'm Montez McCrary, the Practitioner. And in this month's architecture-themed episode of Practitioner Documented, or Docked, it's all good, we're going to be discussing the Richardson Romanesque architectural style. But wait! Richardson Romanesque, you ask? What is that, you ask? Well, that's why I'm here. I'm like a superhero. For you, I will fly. I'll save your life. But not really, but it's a really catchy song. Now, let's get nerdy. Richardson Romanesque is a style of Romanesque Revival architecture named after architect Henry Hobson Richardson, whose masterpiece is the Trinity Church in Boston, Massachusetts, designated as a National Historic Landmark. Richardson first used elements of the style in his Buffalo State Asylum for the Insane in Buffalo, New York, designed in 1870.
Yay, not totally creepy.
So just who is this Henry Hobson Richardson guy? And why is there a whole architectural style named after him? Well, Richardson, born September 29, 1838, and died April 27, 1886, was a prominent American architect who designed many buildings in Albany, Boston, Buffalo, Chicago, Pittsburgh, Milwaukee, and other cities. And along with Louis Sullivan and Frank Lloyd Wright, docked episode 13, Richardson is one of the recognized trinity of American architecture greats from the late 1800s to the early 1900s. The style, unlike Victorian Revival styles like Neo-Gothic, is very freestyle of sorts of Revival architecture, incorporating 11th and 12th century Southern French, Spanish, and Italian Romanesque characteristics with a highly personal synthesis on the Beaux-Arts predilection for clear and legible plans, with the heavy massing that was favored by the medievalist architectural styles. So just a little bit of everything. And I know I said earlier that Richardson Romanesque is a freestyle of Revival architecture. And no, I'm not about to spit some hot fire to explain it, in terms of rhyming anyway. But I will say what's different about the general style of Romanesque Revival of the mid to late 1800s and the Richardson variety of that Revival style. Now, unlike the historic Romanesque style of the 12th century, Romanesque Revival buildings tended to feature more simplified arches and windows than their historic counterparts. Now, it's also sometimes referred to as the Norman style or the Lombard style, and that references the works published during the 19th century after variations of historic Romanesque buildings that were developed by the Normans and the Lombards. Now, like its influence from the Romanesque style, the Romanesque Revival style was widely used for churches and occasionally synagogues and university campus buildings in the United States and Canada. Richardson's fascination with things medieval influenced his designs. He wanted to evoke a sense of permanence, and with his recurrent use of stone, it helped achieve that goal. Now, through carefully planned configuration of proportion, of massing, masonry, his buildings were given a visual weight, making them appear to be anchored to the earth itself. Now, Richardson's design stressed uniquely unusual sculpted shapes, and architectural historians have called his style, in reference to the swelling forms and the intricate detail of many of his buildings, as busty and vivacious. And seriously, if I wasn't just talking about architecture, this would be a completely different episode. Although his style was not new, it was innovative, as it brought a renewed sense of order and proportion to American architecture that had become kind of lost in the myriad of eclectic styles that were very prominent before the emergence of the Richardson Romanesque style. And the fact that his work was then copied to such an extent in the country really proves its influence. Essentially, Richardson Romanesque emphasizes clear, strong, picturesque massing, recessed entrances, richly varied rustication, blank stretches of walling contrasting with bands of windows, cylindrical towers with conical caps embedded into the walling, picturesque roofline profiles, richly varied rustication and polychromy, and rounded semicircular arches supported on clusters of squat columns and windows on massive walls. It's like, got a lot of stuff. Now let me go a little bit into more details about the main features of the architecturally stressed and the eclectic intricacies. Try saying that 5 times fast. Of the Richardson Romanesque style in terms of material, roof, windows, and entrances. Richardson Romanesque buildings were always built of solid masonry stonework, as stone was the preferred material, although it was often mixed with brick. Anyway, solid masonry was used primarily because masonry veneer methods hadn't quite been perfected yet at the time, and stone buildings, back then and even now, are much more expensive to build than wood buildings with said veneer, whether it was limestone, granite, or sandstone. It was expensive. And usually the stonework was typically square shaped, called ashlar, with rough exposed faces, and that's often sometimes referred to as rustication. Now when it comes to roofs, a hipped roof with a lower cross gable was often used, and while there were many, many large square masses capped by a hip roof, sometimes smaller gable roofs were placed at the sides and front to intersect with the larger hip roof. Now the last basic building form most familiar in Washington DC today was the townhouse, which normally used a mansard roof and front gable roof. Now many Romanesque style buildings also had a round or polygonal tower on the roof that were usually conical or pyramidal. And the eclectic nature of the Richardson Romanesque style also generated side-gabled, cross-gabled, and even more roof forms on top of that. Semicircle wide rounded arches were a key feature of the style and were used around doors and windows, but the nature of the design actually required that a true semicircle arc be used instead of a pointed or low spring arc. Now these arches usually rested on short columns that were either freestanding or incorporated into the wall surface, and decorative windows and doorways typically had arched tops and or small columns or colonnettes on each side. Now sometimes three or more arched windows were grouped together, and the windows were recessed deeply into the masonry and used only one large pane of glass per sash. That could be fairly expensive and or dangerous. With the doorways similar to the windows, they had arch tops and small columns, remember the colonnettes from earlier, on each side. However, the masonry type of choice was often arranged in interesting patterns to enhance the entryways and to further embellish the facade. Now this was often done by incorporating decorative patterns etched and carved into the stone lintels and the trim of the entryways. Currently, research is underway to document the westward movement of the artisans and craftsmen, many of whom were Italian and Irish immigrants who built in the Richardson Romanesque tradition. The style began in the eastern U.S. in and around Boston, which is where Richardson built the influential Trinity Church on Coffee Square. Now, as the style was starting to lose favor on the East Coast, it started gaining favor and popularity going westward, as many stone carvers and masons that were trained in the Richardson Romanesque manner very likely took it west until it just died out completely in the early 1900s. In fact, there are 4 small bank buildings that were built in Richardson Romanesque style in Osage County, Oklahoma during 1904 to 1911. And even right here in little old San Antonio, Texas, we got our own little taste of the Romanesque revival slash Richardson Romanesque style buildings, as our Bexar County Courthouse, located downtown, is essentially one of the only beacons of this style of architecture in our city that I know of, but it's the easiest to get to. You know, if you're just cruising around downtown, or you know, just walking, or you know, taking care of some business, or you got arrested for taking care of some business, or you're defending yourself in court, or sightseeing. Remember the Alamo! Episode 1. Thanks for tuning in, everyone. Please like, love, share the video, add it to your favorites. Subscribe to the Practitioner channels on Blip, Dailymotion, and YouTube. And you can follow me on all the social networks!
works.
Check out thepractitioner.com for all the nerdy geekery on architecture, technology, video games, professional wrestling, and other randomness. And if you have an opinion or something you'd like to share and or add, leave a comment below this video and on thepractitioner.com. You can support The Practitioner by going to thepractitioner.com and or by clicking those Amazon US, Amazon Canada, ThinkGeek, and other affiliate links below to shop at those places and support this channel and the website. So I'll see you guys next time, and remember to stay true to yourselves, stay blessed, and stay nerdy.